Hey Lifesavers, and welcome back to my channel. My name is Nurse Kelly Tyrell, and in today's video, we are going to continue our pediatric mini-series by covering some common pediatric cardiovascular disorders and how you as the nurse should be caring for these patients. But before we jump into it, make sure you subscribe to my channel, like, comment, and share this video with a friend, and make sure you click that bell icon to turn on notifications so you don't miss out on any of my upcoming content. If you confuse the different pediatric cardiovascular disorders, symptoms, and treatments, then I suggest you keep watching. The cardiovascular system begins to form and develop between the 3rd and 8th week of gestation. It's the first body system to develop in the fetus, and unfortunately, it's the most prone to congenital defects. Congenital heart defects can occur as one isolated defect affecting the heart solely, or it can be a sign of a cluster of multiple other defects from genetic abnormalities. Each congenital heart defect has its own unique set of signs and symptoms, which we're going to cover in just a few minutes. But there's also some signs and symptoms that all heart defects have in common, which you'll want to be familiar with as a nurse so you can quickly identify potential cardiac compromise in the pediatric patient. When you are assessing the pediatric patient, you want to report these observations immediately to the provider. The first is failure to thrive and poor weight gain, which is going to happen with a heart defect because the infant needs to exert energy to feed and eat. But if the heart is struggling to just maintain oxygenation when the baby is at rest, then the baby isn't going to want to eat and use up more energy. The next is cyanosis and pallor, which means that the baby will have a bluish or a pale color to them. Next is bounding pulses in the neck veins, which can happen again because the heart is pumping really, really hard with each contraction. So blood is forcefully being pushed through all the veins and the arteries in the body. And if fluid starts accumulating because the heart can't adequately circulate all of that blood volume, then you're going to start to see distension or bulging of those neck veins. Next is tachypnea, which means a really fast respiratory rate, and also dyspnea, which means labored breathing. You also want to report any irregular pulse rate because, again, of the extra stress in the heart, you may start seeing different cardiac arrhythmias. And with pediatrics, it's really, really important that you monitor the heart rate because bradycardia or a low heart rate, especially in children, can be an imminent sign that cardiac arrest is coming, especially if the patient is also hypoxic or they have a low oxygen level. You also want to report clubbing of the fingers, which happens from chronically low oxygen levels. Also fatigue during feeding or activity, which we just covered when we were talking about failure to thrive. And lastly is the excessive perspiration, especially over the forehead, because their circulatory system is working in overdrive, which causes a lot of internal body heat. So sweating is the body's way of compensating to try and lower that core body temperature naturally. All right, so now that we have identified some hallmarks of the congenital heart defect symptoms, let's go into details about the most common defects that you'll need to know during nursing school and on the NCLEX. The first class of defects we're going to talk about are defects that increase pulmonary blood flow, starting with an atrial septal defect or an ASD. So the chambers of the heart are separated by septums. So an ASD happens when there is a hole or a defect in the septum that separates the left and the right atria. If you remember from my cardiac anatomy lecture, I said that unoxygenated blood enters the right atria, and then it travels down to the right ventricle, where it's then pushed out to the lung so it can be oxygenated. From there, the pulmonary vein will carry the blood into the left atria, where it pushes that oxygenated blood to the left ventricle and then out to the rest of the body through the aorta. So if there's a defect between both of the atria, some of that oxygenated blood from the left atria will start backspilling into the right atria and through the right ventricle, where it's mixed with unoxygenated blood. So why is this a bad thing? The blood is already oxygenated, so really what is the big deal? Well, it's a bad thing because if the ASD is large enough, the extra blood that's being pumped back into the lung arteries makes the right side of the heart and lungs work extra hard. And the lung arteries can become gradually damaged from all of that extra blood pressure and the blood that's regurgitating or backspilling into the right atria. Now, depending on the size of the ASD, some patients may be completely asymptomatic, and usually ASDs are found on a routine exam because the physician will hear a very distinct murmur. And if an ASD is suspected, then the test you'll likely see to confirm the diagnosis will be a cardiac cath, an echocardiogram, and an electrocardiogram. And if the hole or defect is large enough to cause symptoms and stress on the baby's heart and lungs, then you'll want to anticipate the patient needing a surgical repair with an application of something called a Dacron patch, which is placed over the hole between the left and right atria. And if your patient goes through a Dacron patch repair, then you must make sure that they are on a low dose aspirin therapy for 6 months because they're going to be at really high risk for clotting at the site of the patch. So you want to put them on the aspirin to help thin their blood a little, which can prevent any blood clots from forming. And it also makes it a little easier for the heart to pump blood through the chambers if it's a little bit on the thinner side. So next, let's talk about the most common pediatric heart defect, which is a ventricular septal defect, or VSD. So just like the name suggests, a VSD is a hole or defect in the septum between the left and right ventricle. So with this type of defect, oxygenated blood from the left ventricle is forced back into the right ventricle where it mixes with that unoxygenated blood, and it's then moved back into the lungs where it gets reoxygenated. With this type of defect, you're going to have a very distinguishable, loud, harsh murmur with a systolic thrill. So that is what is going to separate identifying a VSD from an ASD. So you want to put that in your memory bank, that a VSD will cause a very harsh murmur, which can be best heard over the left third and fourth intercostal spaces and along the sternal border with a palpable systolic thrill. With a VSD, because the ventricles hold more blood and they are more powerful, because remember, the left ventricle's job is to forcefully push out all of that blood in the heart to the rest of the body. So children with a VSD are usually more symptomatic, and the VSD is detected typically earlier. Small VSDs can close on their own just like with an ASD, but typically these patients are going to need a surgical patch repair and also place on aspirin therapy for at least 6 months after the repair. Okay, let's finish up this video by talking about the last defect that increases pulmonary blood flow, which is a patent ductus arteriosus. So when a fetus is developing in the womb, the heart creates these secret passageways to bypass or shunt blood away from the lungs because the baby isn't breathing yet, so the blood can't be oxygenated through the lungs. So instead of going through the lungs, the blood will circulate through the heart and it will still get pumped out through the rest of the body until the baby takes its first breath outside of the womb. So once the baby is delivered, these secret passageways are supposed to close within a few weeks, and that actually allows the blood to be pumped from that right ventricle to the lungs where it's oxygenated, and then it's sent back to the left atria and into the left ventricle where it's then pushed out to the rest of the body. Well, sometimes one of these secret passageways called the ductus arterius doesn't close and it causes a PDA, because patent means open or intact. So when this happens, some of the oxygenated blood gets recycled back into the lungs, which causes increased pressure through the pulmonary circulation, and it makes the heart have to pump harder and harder. So initially, the patient may be asymptomatic, but as they grow a little more and the demand for increased blood flow increases, they're going to start experiencing dyspnea or labored breathing. The radial pulse is also going to be bounding with exertion, again from that extra blood pressure in the pulmonary system and the heart. And two other hallmark symptoms are going to be a really wide range between the systolic and diastolic blood pressure, known as a wide pulse pressure. And the last classic symptom is going to be a medium pitched high grade murmur that is best heard at the pulmonic position, which is right around that third intercostal space, just left of the sternum. And it has a really harsh machine-like quality. And I know it sounds silly, but it almost sounds like the drum of a dryer that's circulating on a tumble cycle. So PDAs are one of the more common defects that you're gonna see. And the highest risk patients are going to be your preemie patients, and it occurs twice as frequently in girls than it does in boys. So the gold standard medication treatment to try and close the PDA in preemie patients is going to be indomethacin. And for full-term babies, they're going to typically require surgery to manually close the PDA through a VATS procedure, which stands for a visually assisted thoracoscopic procedure. Now, this is a really important detail to remember. So if a patient is diagnosed with hypoplastic heart syndrome, which we're going to talk about in next week's lecture in detail, but basically it means that the left side of the heart that receives that oxygenated blood is significantly underdeveloped. So if a patient has hypoplastic heart syndrome, then you want that PDA to actually stay open until the left side of the heart becomes more developed or the baby receives a heart transplant. So we want it to stay open because remember I said the reason why the PDA occurs is to help shunt blood away from the lungs, which decreases pressure in the lungs and the left side of the heart, which receives that oxygenated blood. So if a baby has an underdeveloped left side of the heart, then they're not going to be able to handle the volume of oxygenated blood coming from the lungs. So it's actually better to keep the PDA open for a little longer after birth. And the gold standard number one medication you're going to use to keep that PDA open is going to be prostaglandin E. So you definitely want to commit that to your memory bank. Remember, indomethacin closes PDAs and prostaglandin E keeps PDAs open. Make sure you come back around next week because we're going to pick up this lecture and talk about a condition that my sister actually had at birth. And it's the primary reason why I became a nurse. So you don't want to miss out on that video. Also, if you want a sneak peek into my future lectures, make sure you tune in live with me every Wednesday at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. You can tune in live on any of my social channels. I'll make sure to have all the information in the description box below. And that concludes the end of this lesson. I hope that you found this information extremely valuable and it made you just a little more confident as you prepare to take your NCLEX or your next nursing school exam. I just want to thank you all again so much, Lifesavers, for tuning in today. My name is Nurse Kelly Tyrell, and I help nurses feel more confident, increase their test scores, and retain what they don't remember in nursing school. Speaking of, are you a nursing student or soon to be or ready to take your NCLEX? If so, have you joined my online student community yet? If not, then what are you waiting for? The University community is a complete nursing resource hub all at your fingertips. Inside, you can expect to receive coaching, community, and content. You'll get daily coaching with your mobile mentor, me, Nurse Kelly Tyrell. You'll also receive access to weekly educational videos that you can watch months before they even publish to YouTube. You'll also get exclusive printable digital downloads like worksheets, quizzes, flashcards, infographics, cheat sheets, skills checklists, and more. And if this video helped you in any way, be sure to give it a thumbs up. Also, don't forget to smash that subscribe button and click that notification bell so you don't miss out on my upcoming content. Also, if you can do me a favor and drop me a comment below, let me know where you're at with your nursing journey. I'd love to just say hi and connect with you. Also, make sure you click that share icon to spread the word and encourage a fellow aspiring nurse. And last but not least, when you are ready to take your NCLEX, be sure to check out my NCLEX and Chill review, where I review detailed test-taking strategies and cover every major topic that you can expect to find on the NCLEX. If you want to have that unfair advantage and pass your NCLEX on your very next attempt, be sure to click the link in the description box below. Not ready to end the study sesh yet? Well, you are in luck because if you stick around, you can watch more of my videos coming at you in 3, 2, 1. Bye, Lifesavers.